Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
Johnson & Johnson. Financial services firm, Raymond James.
BDO, accountants and advisors.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Major pieces of President Biden's ambitious domestic agenda are at risk tonight amid infighting among members of his own Democratic Party. Hanging in the balance, the bipartisan infrastructure bill and his $3.5 trillion spending package to address health care, child care, the environment, and more. The president spoke about the status of negotiations earlier today.
We're at this stalemate at the moment, and we're going to have to get these two pieces of legislation passed. Both need to be passed.
And Amna Nawaz joins me now. So, Amna, what? Tell us more about this stalemate the president's referring to.
Judy, it's a big acknowledgement from the president, but he's sort of been building his language towards this, and it is very descriptive and indicative of where they are right now. You're talking about two major bills, both central to the president's economic agenda, that $1 trillion bipartisan infrastructure bill, the larger $3.5 trillion reconciliation bill. They are locked up in an intra-Democratic Party battle right now. So we know, of course, centrists want that bipartisan bill to move forward through first alone. It's already passed the Senate. They have some sticker shock when it comes to the reconciliation bill. And progressives want both tracked moving through together. They've even threatened to tank the infrastructure bill if they don't move through together. So, look, President Biden, we know this week has been working to unite both sides, figure out where the common ground is. His language today is very reflective of where they are right now. He ended with that little bit of hope and optimism. They both need to be passed. It's not clear where the common ground is moving forward.
So, given all that, where does it go from here?
So here's where we are today. You've got the leader of the House Congressional, or the Congressional Progressive Caucus, Pramila Jayapal, basically doubling down and saying we are not going to leave behind the things that we fought so hard for, childcare and education and climate and so on, the human infrastructure bill. And she had some tough words for those moderate centrists, for Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema, saying you drafted the infrastructure bill without input from us. We've drafted the reconciliation bill. You now need to come along. Now, Senator Manchin has said this week that President Biden asked him for a number. He said, tell me what you'd support. What would it take to get your support on this bill? Please just continue to work on this. That's where we could see some agreement, if they can come to some kind of compromise on the number. But the House, meanwhile, is going to continue to work through the weekend. Speaker Pelosi's office today told us the Budget Committee is going to continue to mark up that reconciliation bill tomorrow, then goes to the Rules Committee. A source in her office says they are very much moving forward. But in her latest letter to her Democratic colleagues, she did have some careful language. She said, as negotiations continue, there may be changes. So maybe bracing some members of her caucus that some of the details or the contours of the bill could change. It does end with a plan, though. Speaker Pelosi announced she does plan to move forward next week with two bills, both infrastructure and reconciliation. And we should say she pledged to bring the infrastructure bill to a vote on Monday, when, by the way, Judy, the Senate is also likely voting on continuing government funding and raising the debt ceiling. So just all of the things happening on Monday.
All of it's happening all at one time, and we will see what happens. It is going to be a full weekend.
We will see.
Amna Nawaz, thanks very much.
Thanks, Judy.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz at NewsHour West. In for Stephanie Tsai. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Millions of Americans who got Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine are now eligible to receive a booster shot. That is after the CDC's director, Dr. Rochelle Walensky, signed off on her agency's advisory panel recommendations for extra doses for older and high-risk Americans. She also overruled her advisors to expand eligibility to include frontline workers to side with the FDA's recommendation. President Biden praised the decision and pleaded with Americans who have yet to receive their first dose.
Listen to the voices of the unvaccinated Americans who are lying in hospital beds, taking their final breath, saying, and literally we've seen this on television, if only I'd gotten vaccinated. Please don't let this become your tragedy. Get vaccinated. It can save your life, your life. It can save the lives of those around you.
Vice President Harris had her own COVID scare today, moments before an interview with ABC's The View. Two of the show's hosts, Sonny Hostin and Anna Navarro, tested positive for COVID. The vice president, who was later interviewed remotely from another room, did not have any contact with them. A migrant encampment in Del Rio, Texas, where thousands of Haitian migrants had converged this week, has now been cleared. Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas said some 12,400 were allowed into the U.S. to seek asylum. He also expressed outrage over scenes of Border Patrol agents whipping at migrants.
The images horrified us in terms of what they suggest and what they conjure up in terms of not only our nation's history, but unfortunately the fact that that page of history has not been turned entirely. And that means that there is much work to do, and we are very focused on doing it.
Mayorkas said about 2,000 migrants have been flown back to Haiti since Sunday, and more could be expelled in the coming days. The UN now says the death toll from the Syrian civil war is far higher than it previously believed. Its Human Rights Office has documented more than 350,000 civilian and combatant deaths during the decade-long conflict. But it acknowledged the true toll is likely much greater.
Is it not, and should be not seen as, a complete number of conflict-related killings in Syria during this period? It indicates a minimum verifiable number and is certainly an undercount of the actual number of killings. Tragically, there are also many other victims who left behind no witnesses or documentation as to their death.
The UN's death toll numbers are still far lower than the tally from the Syrian Observatory of Human Rights, which estimates more than 606,000 people have died. Ex-Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin plans to appeal his convictions and his 22-and-a-half-year sentence for the murder of George Floyd. In documents filed Thursday, he argued the judge abused his discretion and made multiple mistakes during the trial. Chauvin is representing himself in the appeals process after he was denied a public defender. President Biden will not invoke executive privilege to shield former President Trump's records from the House committee investigating the January 6 insurrection. White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki said they will cooperate with the committee to help get to the bottom of what happened that day. The GOP audit of the 2020 election results in Arizona's largest county has confirmed that President Biden won the state. The findings released today further discredit former President Trump's claims of election fraud. Meanwhile, Texas is launching its own election audit in four counties under pressure from Mr. Trump. We'll return to Arizona's audit after the news summary. The U.S. House of Representatives approved a bill to protect a woman's right to an abortion. It was in response to a highly restrictive Texas law that went into effect earlier this month that has the effect of banning most abortions. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi celebrated today's vote.
This is about women's right to choose, yes, but it's about freedom, freedom of that choice, and freedom from the vigilantes, the bounty hunters that the Texas legislature has set in motion.
The bill's passage in the House is largely symbolic since it is not likely to get the support it needs in the Senate. And speaking of the Senate, its oldest Republican, Chuck Grassley of Iowa, announced today that he will run for re-election next year. The 88-year-old has held his seat for four decades. His announcement gives Senate Republicans more hope they'll be able to hold on to his seat in next year's midterm elections. Prosecutors in Northern California charged Pacific Gas and Electric with manslaughter and other felonies today, alleging its equipment sparked a wildfire that killed four people and destroyed hundreds of homes last year. Investigators determined the Zog fire was started when a tree came into contact with electrical lines owned and operated by the utility company. Still to come on the News Hour, a controversial Republican-led election audit in Arizona confirms Biden won the state in 2020. German voters chart a new future as the Angela Merkel era draws to a close. The jury begins deliberations in the trial of embattled singer R. Kelly, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The widely discredited election review in Arizona is over, but more than 10 months after the 2020 election, there is growing alarm about other efforts launched with no credible justification to sow doubt about elections past, present, and future. William Brangham explains.
That's right, Judy. It was Republicans in the Arizona State Senate who commissioned this review of ballots in Maricopa County, even though elections officials in the state said there was no large-scale fraud in the 2020 election. But a partisan group called Cyber Ninjas undertook this controversial review of the vote, and they affirmed that Joe Biden, in fact, won Maricopa County and Arizona. And here with us to look at the larger context is Nate Persily, a scholar of election law at Stanford University Law School. Nate, great to see you back on the NewsHour. I hesitate to call this an actual audit, what this organization did in Arizona. But they affirmed what we already knew, that Joe Biden won Maricopa County and he won Arizona. But what do you make of this when you look at this process?
Well, you're right to hesitate in calling it an audit. Audits are good things. We know how to do election audits. Every state should audit its elections, but that's not what this was. This really was part of a coordinated disinformation campaign to try to undermine the legitimacy of the election, and we should not put too fine a point on it. That the whole goal here, after the fact, many months after the fact, now almost a year after the election, was to cast doubt on the basic machinery of this election. And as we've seen, you know, even in the sort of public reception of this draft report, the fact that Cyber Ninjas did not find that it affected the outcome hasn't sort of decreased speculation or this lack of confidence that the whole audit process has generated.
And for people who haven't been following this rather circuitous process they took, I mean, this was a very bizarre process, the way they went about this. These people had no experience in election law. They spent a period of time searching for bamboo fibers, allegedly looking for counterfeit Chinese ballots. I mean, the whole process seems bizarre is the official term, I think, for this.
Well, one of the problems is that we don't really know what the basic allegation was as to why there might have been fraud, whether in Arizona or elsewhere. Throughout the last 10, 12 months, you know, what we've seen are allegations, again, of Chinese ballots, as you were saying, in Arizona, of Italian satellites as having manipulated voting machines, right, of Dominion voting machines not being secure, of dead people voting and the like. There's this very heterogeneous set of complaints. And so what Cyber Ninjas was doing was, you know, going on a fishing expedition to find out if there was anything that implicated the outcome. Now, they didn't find that the results would have been different. In fact, they, from their results, they suggest that Joe Biden actually increased his vote totals through their audit than what was found on Election Day. But the fact that it may have sort of confirmed the result should not, you know, be any solace to those of us who worry about the lack of confidence that this type of process has engendered among the mass public.
And as you say, if this were just Arizona, that might be one thing. We might be able to put this behind us. But this is going on in multiple other states now.
That's right. This is now a playbook for other states. If you are a sort of disgruntled politician or one trying to make a name for yourself, then whether it's in Pennsylvania or Wisconsin or some other states, Georgia, now this is a pathway that they've chosen. Now, again, recounts and audits are part of our process. We want to encourage that in the month or so after an election because we want to know that the election machinery is working as intended. But a year after an election, right, all this is trying to do is to undermine confidence in the result.
And it sounds like on some level that perpetual argument that is made is having an effect. There was a Monmouth University poll out a month or two ago that showed that a third of Americans believe that President Biden was elected only because of fraud and that Donald Trump should have properly won the election. I mean, from an election administrator standpoint, if a third of the country thinks that you're engaged in a widespread fraud, what does that do to their ability to run elections safely and soundly?
Well, this is a very dangerous period, I think, for our democracy, that we have not seen this erosion of confidence in the basic infrastructure of America, of the elections in our history. We see lots of retirements among these veteran election officials. We see that many of them feel that they're taking their lives in their own hands because of death threats and the like. And so these are challenges we have not faced before, and they're a direct result of the concerted disinformation campaign that's trying to undermine the legitimacy of the outcome. But these folks are heroes.
Nate Persily of Stanford University Law School, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
Germany is one of America's most important allies, and nearly every American president since George W. Bush has worked closely with German Chancellor Angela Merkel. But for the first time since 2005, she will not be a candidate when Germans head to the polls this Sunday to vote for her successor. Special correspondent Malcolm Brabant is in Berlin with a preview of the upcoming election.
Judy, this is the end of an era. Angela Merkel is slipping away from the political stage with minimal fanfare, which is entirely consistent with her modest, understated style. She's leaving behind huge shoes to fill, and there's a very tight race to replace her as Chancellor.
For 16 years, Angela Merkel has led Germany and been Europe's most dominant politician. They call her Mutti or Mom. Now, as Mutti is leaving the Chancellery, Germany is out of its comfort zone.
I think she'll be remembered as a very important statesperson that kept Europe together.
Peter Neumann is a senior advisor to Merkel's centre-right Christian Democrat Party.
History will remember her as a successful chancellor, as a popular chancellor, as a chancellor that brought Germans a great deal of prosperity.
President Biden saluted the shy research scientist who became the first East German to assume her nation's highest office since reunification.
So wahr mir Gott helfe.
On behalf of the United States, thank you, Angela, for your career of strong, principled leadership. And I want to thank you for your continued support for the long-standing goal of a Europe whole, free, and at peace.
In 2010, Merkel saved the euro currency by coordinating a financial bailout for Greece when it went bust. There were fears that other weak European economies would collapse and the euro would tank.
Europe fails when the euro fails. Europe wins when the euro wins.
Merkel's most controversial unilateral act was to throw open Germany's borders to Syrian refugees in 2015. In all, Germany granted asylum to over a million in that first year of Europe's migration crisis.
And I have to say quite honestly, if we now start having to apologize even for showing a friendly face in emergency situations, then this is not my country.
People across the developing world saw this as an invitation to enter Europe. Only Sweden emulated Germany. Partner nations resented being pressured. Hungary erected a border fence, wrecking the EU's commitment to open internal frontiers. 6 years on, the flow of asylum seekers into Europe is still strong. Sonia Skeets runs a London-based pro-refugee non-profit. She thinks Merkel was right.
Germany and Sweden tried to start a grown-up conversation with other European states, and other European states weren't willing to step up to the plate.
The influx caused a backlash at home, and as Peter Neumann explains, led to a resurgence of the far right in East Germany.
Significant parts of the electorate didn't like it at all, and especially the East, where she's coming from, was very aggrieved about it and still holds it against her. I think that's the point where she lost the former East Germany.
Since Merkel opened Germany's borders in 2015, European right-wingers like French presidential candidate Marine Le Pen have secured a stronger footing with their anti-immigration rhetoric.
Tous les autres All of the migrants who didn't stay in Germany went off amusing themselves in other European countries without asking for our permission. Those who didn't remain in Germany went to Sweden, Italy, and France, weighing heavily on our finances and creating conditions for conflict.
Unlike last time when immigration dominated, climate change is this election's hot issue. Polls suggest that Germany is steering to the left. Most Germans expect Social Democrat Olaf Scholz to replace Merkel. As finance minister in Merkel's coalition government, Scholz is a known quantity, if a little dull. His main rival, Armin Laschet, who replaced Merkel as head of the centre-right Christian Democrats, is also charisma-challenged. But that's not a disadvantage in Germany. The main outsider, Annalena Baerbock of the environmentalist Greens, is predicted to be kingmaker in the next inevitable coalition.
Many citizens can see me as the next head of government, the next chancellor. And I make no secret that, above all, I would like to create a government in alliance with the Greens.
Laschet is promising Merkel-like stability.
I stand for the cohesion of Europe in these difficult times, a climate-neutral industry and a strong economy, and a clear course for national security.
Baerbock wants to force the Christian Democrats into opposition.
I stand for no longer using half measures to protect the climate, a policy that finally brings children and family to its core, and a human rights-led foreign policy in the heart of Europe.
Devastating floods caused by unnaturally heavy summer rain pushed climate change onto the election agenda. The death toll is still unclear, but could be as high as 300. Restoration could cost $30 billion. Activist Jakob Heinsen has gone without food for 3 weeks to highlight climate change. At the hunger strikers' camp, spokeswoman Helen Lubert had harsh words for the Greens.
They're not the solution. Even their program is not enough. And therefore, I think it's important that they're part of a coalition. They do everything they can within the political spectrum, within the parliament. And then we also definitely need opposition from without the parliament.
Facing possible defeat, centre-right parliamentary candidate Klaus-Dieter Gröhle was trying to woo voters with bratwurst and beer.
People are asking critical questions, but I'm not getting the sense that they are really interested in a change of government.
That's not what the polls say. This voter won't be swayed by a sausage.
Angela Merkel was, I think she did a good job overall, but we need to do something different.
As election day approaches, the party of Angela Merkel is hoping Germans will avoid change and play safe, as they have done so often in the past. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Malcolm Brabant in Berlin.
A jury began deliberations today in the federal trial of singer R. Kelly. The R&B artist is accused of kidnapping, bribery, sex trafficking, and racketeering, among other charges. Amna Nawaz is back with our look at the case and a warning for some viewers. This story deals with explicit references to sexual assault.
Judy, R. Kelly has faced allegations of sexual abuse for more than two decades and has settled multiple cases. But this is the first criminal trial he's faced since being acquitted of child pornography charges back in 2008. Over this trial, prosecutors brought 45 witnesses to prove racketeering charges. They argue that Kelly oversaw a criminal enterprise with associates helping to lure underage girls, boys, and young women whom he sexually assaulted and imprisoned. Kelly pled not guilty. Emily Palmer is covering this for the New York Times, and she joins me now. Emily, welcome to the NewsHour. You have been listening to those witnesses as they've shared their testimony, horrifying details. Tell us a little bit about who we've heard from and what they've said.
This case is built on the stories of six women. Five of them testified, and the first woman to take the stand, the first woman to ever actually take the stand and testify against R. Kelly, was a woman named Geronda Pace. She was 9 months pregnant at the time, and she took the stand, and over the course of 2 days, she delineated what she said was a system of abuse that began upon her first meeting with R. Kelly when she was just 14 years old and attended his child pornography trial in Chicago. 2 years later, she met up with the singer again, and he began having sex with her almost from the get-go. She outlined horrific details of sexual abuse as well as physical abuse. And from there, the trial just sort of pushed forward. We heard also from a woman named Stephanie, Sonia, a woman who testified under the name Jane, and another Faith. They all came forward and they talked about the same thing. They had testimony that actually stretched all the way back into the 1990s, all the way into just a few years ago. And they were saying the same story over and over again.
And Emily, as prosecutors say, it wasn't just about the predatory actions of one man, that there was an entire network of enablers around him. Tell me a little bit about how they made that case.
Absolutely. And that network of enablers is actually the whole reason that we're in federal court right now. The racketeering charge that they have put against R. Kelly allows them to go stretch all the way back into the 1990s and bring these stories of horrible things that happened to women like the R&B singer Aaliyah that would normally be too old to actually prosecute. But by charging him with racketeering, something that's usually used against mobsters, they've been able to establish that we're not talking about a successful music company, prosecutors say. We're talking about an enterprise that allows R. Kelly to cash in his fame and stardom to have sex with underage women, girls, and even boys.
So Emily, R. Kelly has pled not guilty. He's denied all the accusations against him. Tell me about his defense team. How did they answer some of these allegations and handle the witnesses?
His defense, from opening arguments through cross-examination of 45 witnesses, through their own 5 witnesses that came and testified earlier this week, through closing statements, have kept to a very specific story. They say this is a complete conspiracy to undermine a successful R&B artist who, you know, enjoyed younger women, but there was nothing illegal about it, they say. They say that these sexual acts were completely, they say that the women were happy to indulge R. Kelly, were fans, even super stalkers at times, that they wanted into the relationships, and then they became jealous and hurt and upset, and they were coming after his money.
Emily, I think a lot of people will listen to this and wonder how. How did this go on for so long without charges of this kind being brought?
It's really important to look at the people who are accusing R. Kelly. And most of the people who have taken, a majority of the people who have taken the stand are Black women who have historically not been heard, especially in cases like this. And this is really a huge moment in the Me Too movement. We've had other trials. We've had Bill Cosby, we've had Harvey Weinstein, but this is the first big high-profile case where a majority of the accusers are Black women. And it's really going to be interesting as the jury continues to deliberate because, you know, for many, many years, people knew what was going on. His employees knew, even to a certain extent, the public knew, and yet nobody did anything.
And we'll be waiting and watching for that verdict. That is Emily Palmer of the New York Times covering the trial of R. Kelly and joining us tonight. Thank you, Emily.
Thank you.
As President Biden's legislative agenda stalls in Congress, he has run into yet another issue, or we should say continues to run into the issue of turmoil on the southern border. For a look at this busy week and what it all means, we're joined by Brooks and Capehart. That is New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, columnist for The Washington Post. Hello to both of you.
Hey, Judy.
Very good to see you.
You too.
On this Friday, and there is so much to talk about. So, David, it does look like there's real trouble for President Biden's domestic agenda. And it's not the Republicans this time, at least on the part that he's run into headwind this week. It's his own Democratic colleagues. What is behind this?
Yeah, it's just an intellectual difference. And what strikes me is how so many people are drawing red lines. The progressives are saying, we want $3.5 trillion. We're not going under. Manchin and others say $1.5 trillion. We're not going over. And so that's a gigantic gap. They can't even agree on when to vote on what. And so I think what they need to do is look at what is the key insight of each side. The progressives are right that we need something big. We're a nation in decline. We're a nation because of disunity. Lots of people have been left behind by this economy. And they're right to do something big to try to jolt us back to unity. The moderates, in my view, are right that we're not going to have a European-style welfare state. We're just not that kind of country. We're an individualistic country. We like to tie benefits to work and have a work obligation. We're never going to give away as much money in taxes as the Europeans do. The Norwegians give away about 46% of their GDP to taxes. If this passed, it would get us up to 19. We're just not that kind of country. So if you take the scope of the progressives and the values of the moderates, I think you can get a deal, but they're pretty far away from it right now.
Well, they both may have a point, Jonathan, but the president's, the future of his term in office could be in the balance here.
Well, sure, it could be in the balance, but we don't know. And I look at this as being the storm before the calm. David's right, a lot of red lines are being drawn, and they seem to be being drawn since Wednesday, since they all went to the White House and had their respective meetings with the president. And then they come out and then they state their positions again. But I've been paying close attention to the language that they're using. They're being very firm about what they're for and what they're not for, but they're not attacking each other the way they were during the summer. And so I wonder if this is the usual Washington theatrics of, you know, just doing all of this performance, and then at some point when we least expect it, breaking news announcement, here's the deal. Now, this is a different Washington. Who knows if that moment is going to come? I pray that it does. One, because what they're arguing over is very important for the American people. Two, if they don't come to some sort of deal, the president's agenda goes from being stalled to dead. And then three, it means finally that Washington is completely broken if they can't come to some agreement here.
Well, it's a different, and then meantime, there's another massive headache the president had. And I don't know whether it's another Washington performance, but it's over the debt limit, David. And this one is between the Democrats and the Republicans. The Republicans are saying, no way.
Yeah, and when the shoe was on the other foot, they wanted the Republicans, when they were controlling things, to take it. It's that what's changed is that 10 years ago, people really used to care about debts and deficits. It was ranked as a major issue by a lot of Americans. Now, for whatever reason, some maybe dubious reasons, nobody cares. Maybe just low interest rates. So now there's much greater tolerance among both Republicans and Democrats to run up the debt. And so voting to raise the limit is not as politically costly as it used to be. I wish they would just do away with the whole thing. We've committed to spend the
with
money.
The debt limit.
We've committed to spend the money. The debt limit just says, yeah, we're going to borrow the money to spend the money we already committed to. So they should raise it to a gazillion dollars, and then we never approach the limit, hopefully. and then they should move forward. It's a bit of ballet that we don't need.
Gazillion? What do you think?
Sure, gazillion is a great enumerator here. But, this is sort of a wonky thing, but it's super important for the American people to understand that raising the debt ceiling is not giving Washington a blank check. It is allowing Washington to pay for the things that they've already bought. If the government does not raise the debt ceiling, Bipartisan Policy Center this morning put out their charts, and they've turned me into a huge debt ceiling nerd. Started back in 2011 when Jay Powell, who was with Bipartisan Policy Center, then put this together. He is now the Fed chairman. I just want the American people to understand this. If the debt ceiling is not raised and the government can't borrow any money, it has to use the cash it has on hand. And I have this chart here. I don't know if the camera can get it, but I'll just talk it through. That on October 15th, which they think might be the first day that we reach that X date, government will bring in $27 billion in revenues, but will have $43 billion in expenses. And that's just on that first day. All that debt, all those things that aren't paid, carries over to the next day. Mm. I don't even have enough time to tell you the avalanche of harm that would come to the American people, to the federal government, and to the global economy if that debt ceiling isn't raised.
And not to mention that government shutdown and all the consequences of that.
Yeah, and both the topics we've talked about so far, the consequences of failure are cataclysmic. And so I presume in a normal functioning democracy that we don't walk over those cliffs, but who knows?
Well, I'm just taking a deep breath here. Another, of course, major issue the president had to deal with this week, again, Jonathan, was the southern border. In addition to what's already been happening there and the Haitian migrants we're starting to gather, in the past week, these images of a border patrol using reins or other whatever, belts mm-hmm. to go after. The migrant President Biden has come in for enormous criticism from fellow Democrats over this. And here's how he commented this morning on what happened.
Of course, I take responsibility. I'm president, but it was horrible what to see, as you saw. To see people treated like they did, horses barely running them over, people being strapped, it's outrageous. I promise you, those people will pay. They will be, an investigation underway now, and there will be consequences.
And today we reported there are no Haitian migrants at that particular place. We don't know whether more will be coming. But Jonathan, how is the president handling this, and how much of a political hit is it for him?
I'll take the political hit first. It's a huge hit. And it's a huge hit, one, with immigration. You know, the president was already on squishy ground with the American people. But those images that came out of the men on horseback and black people running, it was a little too close to home for a lot of us. And for a president who campaigned on a more humane immigration policy, for a president who on election night said to African Americans, "You brought me here and I will not forget it," that's why you had a lot of Democrats, particularly African-American Democrats, saying to the president, what is going on here? You must do something about this. And then on top of it, what made it even more inhumane is that the president, or the administration, deported Haitians who had not lived in Haiti for more than 10 years to a country that is still dealing with an earthquake that happened and a presidential assassination.
How can immigration, every president, counting back as far as we can count, this has been a tough issue. Where do you see this going?
Well, we had our last successful immigration bill, comprehensive one, under Ronald Reagan. That was a long time ago. And so he's inherited a gigantic mess that nobody has had the solution for. I think Biden did make it worse. And part of the problem was they promised on day one they would reverse all the Trump rules. Reversing the Trump rules was a good idea, but doing it all at once on day one, people in the transition in the White House were warning about that. They were saying, we'll be overwhelmed. It'll be a big open door signal, and we don't have the facilities to handle what's about to hit us. And that turned out to be true. And I think what bothers me, aside from what Jonathan was just expressing, was it seems to be arbitrary, like who gets sent where. It seems like it's just like, who knows who's being decided. There's no methodology, there's no procedure for a lot of people. And so we're just overwhelmed right now. And it's disturbing that we're overwhelmed after basically 40 years of this mess.
It's hard to see how this is an issue that gets resolved anytime in the near term. So the last thing we want to bring up is it was September 21st, 2001, just a week and a half after the 9/11 attacks. And here was the beginning of the news hour that night with Jim Lehrer.
And that brings us to Shields and Brooks. Syndicated columnist Mark Shields joined tonight by his new regular partner, David Brooks of the Weekly Standard. Welcome, David.
Thank you.
Formally welcome. Been here many, many times before.
And that man has not changed one iota since September.
Yeah, I wanted to point out I was 12 at that point, so I don't know how old I am now.
David, you had been on the NewsHour, but you joined this program at a very sobering, difficult moment for this country. It was, 10 days after 9/11, and you've been through a lot of ups and downs with the country ever since. But just talk a little bit about what it's meant to you to be here at this table every Friday.
Yeah, I'll tell you what it's been like. Like, it's the end of the week, and often I'm tired. Sometimes I'm under the weather. Sometimes I'm stressed. I come in here a little low. I walk out of here an hour later super charged up and super happy because I get to work with the people I've worked with, not only the people on set, but Leah and the makeuper, Charlie's back there, our lighting guy. And so it's just you feel uplifted when you walk out. And then when you think about 20 years, I think about the time in about 04, 05, Mark and I were on with Jim, and we showed a Marine funeral just before our segment. And Jim started crying. And Mark and I gave like 10-minute answers so Jim could compose himself. And so that was just like, that's something we're going through together. I think about sitting with Mark and Jim when Barack Obama gave this 2004 speech, that first big speech, which was watching a star appear, but it was also about a version of America that he was describing. I think about the day Gwen died, and I go through all the emails that she sent me over the years, and some were just about our friendship, but a lot were tough. Like, Gwen demanded excellence, and if you didn't show up, Gwen was like, show up. And then working with you, I mean, you're the hardest working woman in show business. Like, you have not had a day where you don't completely show up for this thing. And so you get a sense of people who respect their job and mostly respect the audience. And out of that derives a kind of patriotism. And other networks talk a lot about patriotism, but I think we try to serve a certain kind of America. And we try to exemplify that service in a way we do things in the culture around here. And it's just been an honor to be part of that for 20 years. And my next 60 years will be just as good.
Next 60. I mean, the NewsHour has been just incredibly fortunate and honored to have you with us. And of course, Mark for all those years. And then Jonathan joined us almost a year ago. And Jonathan, you get to sit next to David on Friday nights. It's not exactly like every other television show.
No, it's not like every other television show. And, you know, I knew that this was an important job to get. You know, succeeding Mark Shields, the emails that came in from people saying, oh my God, Mark Shields is gone. I'm so upset, I'm so sad, we miss him, but I'm glad you're there. It was then that I realized how important this job is, how important it is what we do. But what makes this so much fun and why it's so wonderful to celebrate David is we've been doing this in other venues for a few years now. And I always look forward to being with David, because you're to the right of me, I'm to the left of you, completely different backgrounds, and yet when I sit with David and talk with David, I feel like I've learned something. I'm smarter. The way David speaks about all the issues, it's inviting, and that's what makes Brooks and Capehart, Shields and Brooks, and all the other iterations of this so wonderful. We come to the table to bring news, educate the audience on the inside, but then to do it in a way that invites the audience in.
There's clearly some magic that happens here, and we are grateful to
thank
be
you, Jonathan.
You.
Thank you,
Horace. To Jonathan Capehart and to David Brooks, congratulations on 20 years more, 40 years more coming up.
Shoot me.
Thank you. Whether teaching NYU marketing students or co-hosting the podcast Pivot, Scott Galloway rarely misses an opportunity to share his insight on the effects of big tech. Tonight, he shares his brief but spectacular take on this country's response to the pandemic. It's also the subject of his latest book, Post-Corona, From Crisis to Opportunity.
Within 7 days of Pearl Harbor, Chrysler converted its largest factory to a factory punching out M1 Bradley tanks. What company has totally pivoted to fighting this virus? If Walmart stock had been down 30% and if Amazon stock had been down 60% instead of up 30% and up 60%, that van with a smile rolling into my driveway delivering my Nespresso pods would have had someone jump out and jab me and my family. This virus has not seen what America is capable of when it has a full-throated capitalist response. The bottom line is, if you're in the top 1%, you are living your best life. That is the dirty secret of this pandemic. This pandemic for the shareholder class has meant more time with Netflix, more time with family, and your wealth has skyrocketed. So for the wealthy, this has been stop, stop, it hurts so good. This has disproportionately impacted people of color who live in food deserts. This has been an enormous tragedy across senior citizens and nursing homes. What we have is the worst of both worlds. Capitalism on the way up, socialism on the way down. That's not capitalism, that's cronyism. We need to be more heavy-handed with corporations and more empathetic and loving with individuals. The biggest mistake we've made in this pandemic was we should have been protecting people, not American Airlines. there is a danger here, and that is the dispersion of headquarters to our homes. The ugly stepchild of dispersion is segregation. When you don't see the homeless veteran on the on-ramp or the off-ramp to work, when you don't see people of different ethnic groups and different income classes, you begin to resent them. So the enduring feature of COVID-19, it will be seen as an accelerant more than a change agent. Online grocery delivery accelerated 8 years. Work from home accelerated 6 years. Income inequality took an economy that was dysfunctional and turned it dystopic. So take any trend in your life, personally or professionally, take it out 10 years, and there's a decent chance that we're here, there, now. I worry that today's youth doesn't have the connective tissue that some of our leaders had in the past. They were Americans first before they were red or blue. And a way to get that back might be some sort of mandatory national service. It might be building housing or a Corona Corps that helps people, where kids get a chance to meet other kids from different backgrounds and feel like they have a shared experience, such that maybe there's more cooperation as they get into positions of power. Some of the greatest periods of prosperity have come out of crisis. And that's the opportunity here. So ask yourself three questions. One, is this an opportunity for you to become a caretaker for someone? Do you have the relationship with your siblings that you want? If you were forced to say goodbye to someone over FaceTime, have you made the requisite investments in friendships to ensure that you maintain those relationships? Are you willing to show the type of grace and courage and forgiveness such that you can cement and repair the most important thing with respect to our happiness, and that is your relationships? This is either going to be the best year in the history of America, or it could be the worst. It's up to us. My name is Scott Galloway, and this is my brief but spectacular take on post-corona, from crisis to opportunity.
Now, an artist straddling worlds and using her art to examine how we see the past and present, East and West. Jeffrey Brown has the story from New York for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
Dancing women from a South Asian painting tradition, a headless Western-style Venus. And what's a fighter jet doing there? Ask the woman with the ornate ram's horns, the artist herself, Shazia Sikander.
I see myself, you know, as somebody who's interested, like a detective, to look at how to connect the dots, how to find where the material is, and to also examine my own relationship with it, but also how some of the stories, what are the archetypal stories within the medium itself.
Sikander, born in Pakistan and living in the U.S. since 1993, is known for examining and breaking down familiar archetypes and stereotypes of art history, and questioning the assigned roles of women and simplistic notions of an East-West divide. She began in art school in Lahore, studying the refined tradition of Persian and Indian manuscript or miniature painting, dating to the 16th century. And then began to play with it and make it her own, adding the image of a friend, for example.
This took me almost 2 years.
Oh, really?
Yes.
In her most renowned early work, called The Scroll, she captured her own life within this history. That's her, a ghost-like presence throughout the scene, which can be read left to right.
At the end, you also see her. She's painting herself, but you never really get to see her face. So there's always this level of mystery.
In fact, the entire exhibition, titled Extraordinary Realities and starting at the Morgan Library and Museum in New York, is a kind of portrait of the young artist, mostly paintings from Sikander's first two decades of work in the 1990s and early 2000s. A chance for us and her, now 52, to look back, but also see continuing connections.
I was interested in examining some of those projections, like, what is tradition? How do we define tradition? How is tradition performed? And those ideas captured my imagination as a young artist, that who dictated when and what in time is old and what is avant-garde? And the more I examined it, the more I felt like there was room to re-examine, to reimagine.
She began to layer image upon image, sometimes adding fantastical creatures, and abstraction over refined details. She packed different kinds of information into small paintings, often using humor and wit. Angels with American flags for wings, in a reference to U.S. military interventions in the Muslim world. In 1999, she did a painting titled The Faces of Islam for the New York Times Magazine.
What is the role of art that you see for addressing or responding to those kind of stereotypes?
The work was always resisting that type of fetishization, especially about the Muslim woman as needing to be saved, especially in how it gets played up in Hollywood, in media, in TV, and it has a deeper history of the representation of the veil in European colonial imperial history. And it counters it with other types of narratives where the joyousness of the feminine, the inherent female agency, autonomy, ability to be creative, where its inner beauty, its inner strength is very present.
That shows itself especially in Sikander's first sculpture, Two Women Intertwined, a classical Venus and Hindu Devata. Both, she says, in a position of power. In recent years, Sikander has worked in new forms and larger formats, including massive billboard projections in Times Square and a 66-foot glass and ceramic scroll for Princeton University.
So I made this here. I basically took elements from some of the paintings.
She created a new installation for this exhibition, long strips of paper that bring her small painting and imagery to three-dimensional life and draw in the viewer. Regularly defined herself as South Asian, Pakistani, Muslim, and more, she's been determined to break out of the boxes.
The more the categories, the merrier. If the work can speak to Asian Americanness, fine. Muslim Americanness, fine. Female artists, fine. Artists, great. All those categories and boxes are fine as long as, you know, one is not restricted to just operate from within one or two. And I think when we talk about that, we are talking about the agency of imagination. And that's the best part of being an artist, is that you can really soar.
Shazia Sikander's exhibition, Extraordinary Realities, moves next to the Rhode Island School of Design Museum in Providence, and then to the Museum of Fine Arts, Houston. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at the Morgan Library and Museum in New York.
Some soaring art there. And a new app that helps people overcome a fear of spiders, the plan to train cows to protect the environment, and an invasive bug threatening America's trees. Those are among the five stories you may have missed this week that we are highlighting online. You can find all that and more on our website at pbs.org/newshour. And be sure to join my colleague, moderator Yamiche Alcindor, tonight on Washington Week. She'll get insight and analysis of the week's big stories from an all-star panel, including Bob Woodward and Robert Costa, authors of the best-selling book, Peril. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here on Monday evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe and have a good weekend.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
The landscape has changed, and not for the last time. The rules of business are being reinvented with a more flexible workforce, by embracing innovation, by looking not only at current opportunities, but ahead to future ones. Resilience is the ability to pivot again and again for whatever happens next.
People who know BDO. Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. and friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS News Hour West. From WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.